It's the Wil Shriner Show with Will's guest from Family Ties, Michael Gross. Facts of Life star, Nancy McKeon. David Heil with home science projects for the kids. And fitness expert, Gladys Portuguese. And now, Wil Shriner.
Sorry about that. I don't know what happened with our audience. They went crazy. They went nuts. How are you? Welcome to the show. Thanks for joining us today. We've got a great show lined up for you today. We have these home science projects for the kids to do with their parents. It's an exciting thing. Is technology advancing so quickly for you guys, or is it just me? Is it tough to keep up with all this stuff?
Yeah.
Well, you know, one thing we like to do on the show, we feel kind of it's our duty here, really, to keep you up to date on some of the latest inventions that have come in straight from the patent office. So if we could bring it in now. This is a little segment we like to call New Inventions, things that are coming your way from the patent office. The first item of business, I don't know if you've seen this yet, the personal hygiene phone. Huh? Why waste time on the phone when you can be doing so many other things at once? You clean your ears and brush your teeth at the same time. Business executives can just brush after every deal. Isn't that... How about this? Have you seen this? This, I think, is bigger. The dessert disguise kit. This covers a pie or a cake to keep the kids away. What kid's gonna look under an onion for a piece of chocolate cake like that, huh? Whoa, we had no idea that'd be so popular. This is now, how many times have you had this? The boss is coming over for that big barbecue, and he likes his steak medium, and you want it to be perfect. Well, it can be done now if you buy the new zipper steak. Yes. Just zip it right open. Medium, just like the boss likes it. What's next, a button-down pork chop? Who knows? Now, this one I think will do very well, the pasta pump. I don't know if you've seen this. Pump the top, and out comes the pasta. Watch. What could be simpler, huh? Luciano Pavarotti has two of these in the front seat of his car. It's, Ready? Spinach, my favorite, too, by the way. Okay, moving along now. How many times have you been in an emergency situation? Well, not anymore, you. This is perfect with the new... This is a can o' pants. Have you seen this? You spill coffee on your pants or you split a seam? Well, voila, all you do, you just open this can. Let me get through this real quick. And what do you got? You've got instant trousers. This, of course, is the hungry man size. Here you go. Can o' pants. These are not from my personal collection. These come in various sizings, depending, of course, on the size of your can. All right, finally. Hey. How many of you never have enough clean socks? Can I see a show of hands? A few people? Problems are gone now with the new Rolo socks. Just tear them off as you need them. Argyle, sweat socks, whatever you want. They come in 1 and 2 ply. Don Johnson may not need something like this, but for sock wearing folks like you and me, I think it's perfect. Anyway, that's a look at tomorrow's inventions today. Some may catch on, some may not. Anyway, stay put. We got a great show ahead. From Facts of Life, Nancy McKeon will be here, plus David Heil with home science projects for the kids. Fitness expert Gladys Portuguese will be here. And to tie one on from Family Ties, Michael Gross, right after this. Don't go away. Welcome welcome back to the show. My next guest heads the Keaton household on one of the TV's most popular series, Family Ties. He rules with a firm but funny hand. Let's take a peek at him in action here. Watch this scene.
You're all here. Now's a good time to go over what we're going to say when Warren gets here.
No, Alex, I know exactly what I'm going to say. I've been waiting 18 years to discuss you with someone in mental health.
Look, Mal, you got to be very careful what you say to a psychologist. That's why I've drawn up some appropriate comments.
Alex is more than a son. He's a friend. A companion. Someone with whom I can spend many happy hours discussing politics, world affairs, and current events. Alex, I'm afraid if I read this aloud, I'll be struck by lightning.
Please welcome Michael Gross. Thank you.
These people are whipped into a frenzy.
Well, you know, perhaps it was the spinach pasta that got them that way.
No, I want to thank you. A lot of times you come to shows like this, and it's customary to, get a basket of fruit or wine or something like that. And I just want to thank you for the can of pants I found in my dressing room.
And they look so good on you, too. Those are the deluxe.
Almost the right size.
So how you doing? I know your sister. I did a Tonight Show with your sister once, Mary Gross.
Oh, you did? Yes. Yeah, right. I was never up that late, but she told me she had a good time.
Yeah, she's terrific. And you're terrific on that show. It's warm.
Thank you very much.
It's funny. It's doing so well.
Who could imagine that we would have been here for, we've done about 130 episodes, and I can't believe it, it's a crapshoot, as you know. You think you're going to maybe do 8 or 13 and get out and get lucky, and here we are beginning our 6th season now.
Did you have any idea going into it that it was going to be so successful?
No. I think in many cases you make a pilot and think it's going to, maybe air as a movie of the week or something like that, and then you'll never see it again. But I think we have some very good writing to thank for the success.
Sure.
There are going to be no big changes this year, probably. More of the same. I hope to get some more dimension. One of the best things I think that happened to me in the last year or so is the character of Nick, who arrived on the show, Mallory's boyfriend. Because, I think for a long time, Stephen, and we were trying to depart from this kind of knee-jerk liberal, but every time Nick walks into the room, Stephen turns into Archie Bunker right before your eyes. He loathes this young man, so that sort of thing is fun, and we hope to develop more and more of that sort of dimension.
Yeah, but your characters, well, no, dimension now. Do you have to wear those 3D glasses to watch this show now?
Exactly.
But your character's really gone through a few changes over the years. Do you have any input into
that? To some degree. I mean, sometimes we pull goofy things from my own household. One time we were in a show, we were looking for Stephen sort of going off in a very liberal slant, and the producers had the other kids coming in saying, Dad's going crazy. We didn't see any of it on screen in the first draft, and I said, wait a minute, here's something from life.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that so annoys my family sometimes, and this is really true, I will occasionally go through the garbage. This is not my hobby. I just, when I'm throwing something away, and I happen to look down and I see an aluminum can in the garbage. Now, we happen to be a recycling family, and this sort of thing bugs me, because we have bins for these things. We recycle glass and aluminum and all that sort of thing. And so I'll march into the kitchen and say, all right, Who did it? Fess up. And they wrote that into an episode of Family Ties once. They took it a step further, too, where Stephen was also against using English muffins while the British were occupying Northern Ireland.
That's taking a stand.
Yeah, I'll say, But, they start with a germ of an idea like that, something that happens to me. And so we do throw in those crazy little things. I'm just as annoying at home as I am on the television show to my children.
Yeah, now you guys got a big change for the whole show. You're moving to Sunday night.
Right. We have an additional cast member, Courtney Cox, uh-huh. who will be Alex P. Keaton's new girlfriend. And the rumors are not true about Michael Fox leaving his old girlfriend for Courtney. In fact, Michael Fox has left his old girlfriend for me. I'm not wearing a wedding ring, see? No. No, and... But she will be Alex's
Does she move into the house with you guys?
Not that I know of. But of course, I'm not too up on these scripts. I just work there.
I mean, warn her about that recycling can thing. In case she
right.
Comes
well,
in.
She'll be the first to know.
But Sunday night now, are you worried about having up against what Murder She Wrote?
You're right. Personally, I'm not worried. I think my mother's worried. She has viewing habits, you know, and may interfere with choir practice or something like that. But personally, no. I mean, I think we're not going to go down the tubes, my feeling is, I'm sorry it has to be so competitive. Yeah, that's what it's about, you know. But I've worked with Angela Lansbury, actually, in a television movie called Little Gloria Happy at Last. I worked with her a couple years ago. She's a wonderful actress. People should watch Angela Lansbury. She's a wonderful talent. It's a pity we have to be opposite each other. And I hope we smear her all over the... she's wonderful, and I just hope the sales of the VCRs go up, and they watch us and tape Angela.
But you guys are not gonna make any changes. You're gonna start having like dead bodies laying around your set.
No more than usual. No. I'll say we were up against the Fall Guy in our first season, and we'd always talk about having to compete with vats full of naked women. Roller derby women in vats of hot oil. So every week on...
Well, we're up against that every day.
Well, that's just the audience.
Now, you got a new TV movie coming out as well. You're constantly working.
In the off-season, I did a television movie, and I think this will be very interesting. Two people you'll see in a very different mode. First of all, myself and Raquel Welch. And the best part about working with Raquel is watching the reaction of my male friends when I tell them I'm working with Raquel. But it's a tough life. Meredith Burney in part of the year and Raquel in the other. But it's,
you have a lot of friends hanging around the set when you're shooting.
Right. And it's a story, ultimately. This is a dramatic piece about a woman who contracts ALS, better known to most of you as... Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. It took me 4 weeks of filming to learn how to say that. But it's a woman who contracts this disease, and it is ultimately fatal in every case. And it is a disorder that sometimes takes a long time to happen for this. And the story involves the destruction. A terminal disease has on the relationship between a husband and a wife, and ultimately the whole family. And ultimately, just when you think you've got it figured out, it becomes about euthanasia. That's where the controversy, I'm sure, is going to come in.
Does working on a movie like that affect your life? I mean, do you get more involved?
I came home every weekend from that 5-day-a-week filming, and just sort of held my wife and said, "Thank God we are healthy. Thank goodness." And actually, I became so interested in this, I became involved with the ALS Association, and am now beginning my relationship with them as a kind of spokesperson for this. I resisted that sort of thing for a long time, didn't lend myself to a lot of causes. I mean, it's a very Hollywood sort of thing. You go to a PR person, and they say, "Okay, do you play golf? Do you play tennis? Okay, we can get you in the tennis and the golf thing. So, what's your favorite disease? You know?" And you say, "Well, I stopped smoking 5 years ago. The lung society. No, Larry Hagman's got that. I'm sorry. I didn't have a disease. You know, now I have a disease. I have personally become very involved in this, and I'm sure all the public relations people are going to be very happy. They know where to put me now.
So now, I saw you're a hobbyist. You're a big train
enthusiast. Yes. This is something that's become well known to some people. I had a grandfather who worked for 56 years for the Santa Fe Railway. My late grandfather. He passed away last year at the age of 90. And he was quite a railroader. And there were a lot of railroaders in our family. And even I did it for a while, working my way through college. And I was very close to Gramps, and I have become an inveterate train rider, and do it all the time. I collect railroad memorabilia.
You think trains get a bad rap, though? They say it's like Greyhound on rail.
Well, not in Europe, you see, but that's the difference, is they spend the money. Mm-hmm. I mean, we will subsidize interstate highways and the Federal Aviation Administration and the air traffic controllers and all this sort of thing, but we don't want to spend money on Amtrak. That doesn't make sense to me. There's no accident that the trains are so good in Europe. They pay for them.
They
pay for them and they use them, and people will use them better they are and all this sort of thing. I do it all the time. I find it very relaxing. For example, going from here to New York, people think I'm...
You take a train?
Yes, I do.
How long a ride is that?
It's three nights on a train, right. That's those arrows whizzing through the,
Oh, it's only 3 days?
3 days.
And you brought a little piece of train memorabilia?
Yeah.
What is this exactly?
People said, bring something into... This is kind of interesting. Well, I collect a lot of railroad memorabilia. Now, this is something weird, huh? You think I'm going to look for water up here. It's called an order hoop. Maybe some of you have seen this before. Before the days of radios used on trains and two-way communication like that, they passed up a lot of written orders to trains. Now, they could pass up an order while the train was moving along. The train wouldn't have to stop, and telegraphers all along the way would keep track of trains and things like that, and they would pass up written orders to trains. I'll demonstrate it.
Okay.
It's a wonderful little bit of simple technology that I really like. If you stand up a minute.
All right.
Widen out now.
I'll be the train.
So, all you have to do is stand in one place, and basically... What you do is what you're trying to do is put your hand through the middle of this. Some guy would stand at trackside, let's say, and hold this up to the engineer, and the train would go by, and he'd just sort of go whoop like that, and it would come right up on his arm.
And he's got this.
And the train wouldn't have to stop, and
And the notes on here?
He's got the orders on there about what's happened. And
get me off this train.
Right. The brakes.
That's a great invention. Michael, the movie we'll look for.
Thanks. Yes, I should. If I get off of this without telling you the air date, someone will kill me. It is October 12th. It is Columbus Day. That's a Monday night. It's opposite Monday Night Football, but I guess the network feels if Rock Hell can tear the guys away from Monday Night Football, no one can.
Yeah, and the movie's called Right to Die.
Right to Die.
Michael Gross, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here, Michael. Come back and visit.
Thank you.
Thanks. We'll be right back with more of the show. Don't go away. Right after this. Welcome back to the show. My next guest describes himself as an everyday scientist. He says you can keep a kid entertained for hours with things in your refrigerator. Sounds like a good thing to me. From the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry, please welcome David Heil. David?
Just trying, huh?
Keep a kid busy for hours in the refrigerator. But is that simple? A lot of good stuff in the refrigerator?
Hours on end. In fact, that's why you use the phrase everyday science.
What is an everyday scientist as opposed to
it's the science that you do all day long, every day of your life. And the sooner we can find out that it's fun, the more fun we can have with it.
Okay, and you brought some demonstrations of some potential fun we can have.
Fun in your home, basically things that you can get right from the grocery store shelf and bring home and play with.
Okay, David, what's the first, this green stuff?
Green stuff here, those of you out there that remember a Dr. Seuss story called Bartholomew and the Oobleck. You may remember that this green goo rained down on the kingdom, and it was very difficult to get rid of because it's strange material. Stick your finger in that, Will.
Ooh.
Whoa, okay. Feels kind of soft now. Look at this, though. It's solid.
Soft yet solid.
Soft yet solid.
Like pudding.
pudding that isn't working quite right. Uh-huh. Pudding that you don't want to serve to your mother-in-law.
Okay, what's this made out of?
This is made out of cornstarch and water. One cup of water to a box of cornstarch and some food coloring to make it green. Very simple. Will, just hold your hand over that cup. I want to put this quickly rolled ball of gorgeous oobleck in your hand and take a look at this property.
Ooh.
What
ooh.
Happened to the ball?
Ooh. Nice to meet you again, Doctor. Ooh, a very weird texture.
Isn't
can you
that
reform
strange?
It or is that
you can reform it and then it'll just do it again. And the reason for that is that the cornstarch is ground into this very fine powder. And the starch molecules lay like little platelets. And so when you pound on them, those plates just kind of lined up and hold their rigid form. When you slowly stick your finger in it or pick it up, it will eventually just kind of glob and glue like a liquid.
So you recommend this for the kiddies to do what?
I really do. To take
it
off of the carpet in the living room, right? Uh-huh. Somewhere out of reach, and maybe in the garage or on a patio, and describe the properties, do some discovery with it. Maybe invent things to do with it. What are you going to do with it?
I don't know. I'm just I mean, all I can think about is, ooh, I've got this nasty cold, Doc.
Just a way to gross out the brother and sister.
You remember that because we're rolling in the ball, right?
Okay.
Why don't we step over here and wash up before we move on to the next thing? You want some help with that?
Sure.
Okay,
thanks.
Got it.
Ooh, okay.
Let's do a quick wash up here.
You bring a shower cap?
No, but I did bring my snorkel and fins for the pool over here.
Okay, there you go. Stuff is great. This
All
is
right. Well, some more kitchen materials here.
More kitchen items.
Standard soft drink bottles here with some balloons, and we're going to make balloon bottle rockets.
All right.
And I'll give you your rocket here. That's your the green rocket.
Now, wait a minute. This looks like a balloon.
It is, yeah. And what we're going to do is we'll kind
of
do this together here and help each other out at first, and then we're going to compete, downright compete. Why don't you hold that for a second?
So you take a balloon, you take a funnel, you take
baking soda.
Like baking soda,
standard
but different.
soda. Do you bake bread with baking soda?
I don't bake anything. I'm the worst cook in the world.
All right.
You've lost me already on...
We'll put some of this baking soda in
here. How much
do
you put in? Fill up the balloon?
No, we don't want to fill it up too full because we'll shoot it right out of the top of the studio here, and we might be in trouble there. All right.
Okay.
That's my rocket. Let me tilt this upside down for a minute.
All right.
Got to be prepared to make a bit of a mess when you're playing with science goodies at home.
But these are just ordinary stuff that kids can
These things can be done on a Saturday afternoon. You can have kids over. They're great party things if you've got birthday parties for young children at home. Real good for the middle elementary age child. All materials that are quite safe. There's no problem there.
So if the kid's playing with plutonium right away, you know this.
Right. That's the last activity we're going to do, Will.
Okay.
All right, now, you've got your rocket ready. Take the balloon off the funnel there.
You don't think mine has less powder?
Well, you are competitive, aren't you?
I think you already got this fixed.
I'm going to don't put it on yet.
Okay.
You'll have a real dead balloon.
All right, so then you add what, vinegar
to
it?
Then I'm
going to
add some vinegar here.
Okay.
And the trick is we'll tilt these balloons up at the same time. Don't get too competitive. I mean, they're about the same.
About the same. Okay, I just want this
we're
to be fair.
We're going to tilt these up at the same time.
There may be some wagering in our studio audience.
And when I say tilt it up, be sure to hold this on real tight. The reason you do this is so the reaction doesn't happen real fast before you're ready for it. We're going to tilt this up.
What is the reaction?
It's a baking soda reacting with vinegar to produce carbon dioxide gas.
You ever kill a kid with
fills
this?
Fills a balloon. No. I don't kill kids with this. I suppose cats or dogs, if they got in the way, might be in big trouble. Mothers are probably cringing in the kitchen, watching out the window. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
We're going to tilt this baby up. Hold it on tight.
Look at
the balloon starts filling up.
Oh!
Will, I'm just going to let mine keep going.
Well, I guess
so
I
much
lost,
for your So much for your competitive spirit. Are you ready for this rocket to blow here? One, two, three, right up into the lights here and the microphones.
Yeah.
Baking soda rocket. Are you all right today?
Okay. Okay, we got one last. Maybe I can win this one. I told you to put it up.
I rigged it, didn't I?
All right. Now what happens
balloon.
With this is the. I like this one.
This is fun. This is what we're going to use this pool over here for. We're going to make some boats. This is yours.
Okay.
Will's Wonder. Is the Super Soda boat. And we're going to just use the same materials, basically.
A little plastic.
We're going to put a little bit of vinegar in here. These are common hand lotion bottles. You could use any plastic bottles. I've got a couple others sitting out here.
Hydrogen peroxide. This, of course, has the straw in it.
Right. It's like an outboard motor.
Uh-huh.
And a little juice bottle. We'll fill these about half full. We're going to wrap the baking soda in colored tissue paper.
Okay.
You have any idea why?
Now you got me on the spot. Because you couldn't get plain tissue paper?
That's a thought. No, we're going to do it for two reasons.
React.
We want to slow down the reaction, which is what you had in mind.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also going to maybe get some color out of this tissue paper if it's not color fast.
So I use the blue.
You use the blue for Will's Wonder.
Is the blue faster?
And I should tell you yes just so you feel better because
sure.
I don't want
green
you to lose
balloon
twice.
The green balloon didn't do too well.
You do have the bigger boat. You know that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All right.
I told you not to bring that up.
What I want you to do... Exposing the basics here in your competitive spirit. We're going to roll these like a little cigar. It's got to fit through there now.
Okay.
So roll it small enough to fit through. Roll her up like a little tissue paper baking soda cigar, something you probably did in college, right?
Oh, all the time. Cigar rolling 101, I think, was...
All righty.
Okay, so...
Now, don't put it in yet. Keep it tight. We're going to carry this over to the pool.
I don't have a cap over this.
There's your cap.
All right. Here we go. Come over to my little pool here.
Now, that cap is going to work like an outboard motor.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I've gone with these hand lotion caps. It's kind of the new age baking soda boat. You can leave it closed until your bottle starts bloating a little bit. Then you want to open it fast.
Okay.
Put her in there, and the boat takes off. So we're going to put these in.
Okay.
Seal her tight. Quickly.
Quickly. Okay, there
Shake it a little bit.
Shake it. All right, this is all the kids need.
Baking soda, vinegar, and a lotion bottle. And open that baby up, and off go the boat!
Yeah! That's terrific.
Now, there's a drawback, of course. If the kids are in the swimming pool while they're doing this, they're going to come out smelling like Easter eggs.
Oh, is that so you basically just yeast right up out of here with all the baking soda? David, these are great inventions. Thank you for coming here and sharing these with us.
It's a pleasure.
We will be right back with more of the show. David Heil from Portland, Oregon. Don't go away. We got more coming up right after this. Hi, welcome back. My next guest has been in show business since she was a toddler. She's grown up on the popular series Facts of Life, and now she's producing her own projects for television. Please welcome Nancy McKeon. Nancy? Thank you for being here. You
Thank
look
you.
So lovely.
Oh, you look great.
Wow, these are rented clothes. You're doing well. Congratulations. You went from being an actress to producing now. Did you basically do that so you can do what you want, or?
It's a lot. You have a little more control after the picture is done. You have a little more control before and some control afterwards, you know, with casting and then afterwards with music and post-production.
So you really like all that stuff better than, would you give up acting to be just a producer?
No, never. I love being in front, but I also like having a little bit more control.
Mm-hmm. Now, you picked an interesting project about schizophrenia. What led you to do this, a movie on this?
Well, you know, I can't deny that it was a great piece. It's good for me to get away from, you know, the sitcom mold and go out and do something different. But it's also an important subject. It's a subject that not a lot of people talk about. They sort of dismiss it. It's not big like cancer or AIDS, and it doesn't get as much research. So hopefully this will bring it more, you know, into the forefront.
Does it go into explaining what the causes and cures are? There are no cures for schizophrenia.
No, there is no cure. If you get it, you get it, and you pretty much have to readjust your entire life.
Who's stricken by it?
Mostly between the ages of 16 and probably up till 25. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you just get it. And I mean, you know, it comes on in little stages, and then it can pretty much destroy your life.
Yeah. And what is the movie? The movie deals with someone?
I get it. And it's not your ordinary disease of the week movie. You know, I didn't want to make that. I wanted to show something different. So this basically deals with the decline of the family that she's in and how a life can really just be destroyed.
Wait, what's a disease of the week movie?
Well, you know, when you get it, if somebody, you know, big gets a disease, and of course they get a cure at the end, and yay, we're all happy and fine and we're all well.
Okay.
This isn't that at all. There is no cure, so it can't be that great at the end. There can only be a little bit of hope at the end that you find, you know, because not many people have, you know, $60,000 to go to a lush, beautiful, laid out, you know, home where you can be taken care of and given proper medicine. You know, nobody has that kind of money, and most of the people end up on the streets, and that's a terrible thing. A lot of the people you see on the streets talking to one another, or talking to themselves, another.
In New York, you see that a lot. People walk around. Lily Tomlin used to do a joke about they should pair them up so it looks like they're having a conversation.
I know, and that's what's said. A lot of people just dismiss them as people who have no will or don't want to work for a living and just want to live off, you know, everybody else. And that's not true some of the time. Yeah. I'm not saying all of the time, but some of the time they really have a problem and they need help.
Is that what you wanted to accomplish by doing the film? You wanted to show people that some of the answers?
I think so. You know, it's really sad because there are no rehabilitation centers. California has... where this Los Angeles has one place in Santa Monica where they can go and have some kind of rehabilitation. Other than that, there's no place for these people to go. And what do? You know, they're just cast out onto the streets. You can only hold them for so long in an institution.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, you know, they just keep, you know, the cycle just keeps being repeated.
Yeah. All right, we brought a little scene from the movie. Do we need to set up?
This is, we didn't want to show anything too depressing. This is right at the beginning. She's at college. Everything is, you know, going, you know, status quo for you know, that kind of a girl. And this is the very beginning of the disease, where just little hints of things start to happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, take a look at the monitor. Watch the videotape at home.
You're quite beautiful when you're peevish and ill-tempered.
Yeah, well, I know that. Tell me something I don't know. I know that.
Yeah.
I know that too.
Yeah.
Okay, that's new.
Where's Jenny?
Why?
No, I just don't want her popping in on us, that's all.
Do you like to watch yourself work?
Not at all.
So many actors, they look away. What the name of the movie is not, it's Silent Partners?
Silent Voices.
Silent Voices.
I'll be very honest with you, okay? We did the movie as 72 hours, but not many people know that, you know, 72 hours is how long you can hold people for. They all think, you know, where's Eddie Murphy? You know?
Oh, they think it's a sequel to 48 hours.
Sequel to 48 hours, okay? Just longer, right?
So, well, maybe they think it's just a real long movie, you know? 72 hours!
So, Mr. Tartikoff needs to okay a title.
I call him Brandon. I don't know.
Really?
Yeah.
can you get me to call him Brandon? Maybe we'll get a title. Anyway, so he came. So far, we have Silent Voices.
And somebody, you said you broke your ankle on the making?
The very last day, the very last shot, the very last everything, at 10:30 on a Friday night, I get in front of the camera dolly. We're doing a tracking shot, and they're trying to shoot me through the window. Real, you know, artsy-fartsy shot. And the camera operator is telling me to go slower. You got to slow up so I can shoot you. And the car is going faster, so the dolly keeps getting faster. And so he just took the back of my ankle and popped my